All creatures pass on some characteristics of themselves to their offspring. When those characteristics are well adapted to the surrounding conditions, those offspring will thrive and go on to produce offspring of their own. Of course, the flip side of this is that the characteristics turn out to be poorly matched to conditions, lead to lower survival and fewer offspring. The all-time classic example is that of the peppered moth. Prior to the Industrial Revolution, peppered moths were almost all pale in colour. When soot from nearby factories blackened the trunks of many trees, these pale moths were easy picking for woodland birds and their numbers dramatically reduced. Very soon though, the decline in pale moth numbers was replaced by a matching increase in the number of moths which had a particular mutation that caused them to be very dark in colour. The proportion of dark moths changed from perhaps around 0.1% prior to industrialisation to around 98% in areas that were affected by soot. Fortunately, as air quality recovered and soot levels dropped, there was still enough pale moths to support a return of their numbers as the tree trunks became lighter. The hugely overriding factor that drove these changes was the susceptibility to predation, and the peppered moth, this was controlled by the action of a single gene. Natural selection at work. Just as with peppered moths, it's the genetic code in wild trout that helps shape them and their ability to survive and thrive. Genes interact with cues from the environment to produce a whole host of characteristics. These might be things that are easy to see, such as coloration patterns, or they might be invisible to the human eye, as in the case of resistance to certain diseases. The way that fish behave is also influenced by their genes, with the timing and location of breeding efforts, or predator avoidance skills, being good examples. Wild brown trout have successfully colonized a huge variety of habitats and river systems, and a large part of their ability to do this stems from the unusually large variation that's present within that total brown trout gene pool. This gene pool is what you'd get if you identified and wrote down every single gene and every variation of that gene from every individual brown trout in existence. The more variation in genes that exists within a species, the more chance that some individuals can adapt to new or different environments. In other words, more variety within the gene pool of a species leads to a greater adaptability of that species. Just imagine if the last pale peppered moth had gone extinct before the trees recovered their natural pale coloration. That vital characteristic would have disappeared, and the moths might not have been able to adjust to the new environment. The fact that a single individual does not carry all of the variation that exists in the entire gene pool is very important. Some fish would be able to adapt to certain conditions, whilst others would perish in that same scenario because they lacked the required characteristics. This is the basis for distinct populations that are ideally adapted to their local conditions. The crucial point to realise is that the ability of different trout populations to adapt and thrive in these varied environments would disappear if particular genes became extinct. Because all domesticated strains of trout are originally bred from wild parents, the genes in stockfish come out of the total pool of genes found in the brown trout species and will be shared by some wild fish. However, stockfish genes are restricted to only a small portion of the total library of trout genes. The restriction is a direct result of fish farm conditions only favouring certain characteristics, and only very few wild trout possess those characteristics. Farm conditions, and consequently many of the domesticated trout characteristics, are pretty much the same in trout farms across the world. You could view it as conditions in trout farms forming just one background for natural selection to occur. In a way, this is similar to one type of moth being suited to one particular colour of tree. Because of the large variety of streams and rivers that farm fish are stocked into, and because all these are very different from life in captivity, there's very little chance that they'll make the best match for their new home. A bit like taking a dark moth from a dark tree and then rehoming it on a nice pale tree trunk. In fact, studies show that when compared to wild fish, features like predator avoidance and disease resistance are lower in artificially produced fish. Now, as well as having a poor chance of making a good match, let's look at the surprising fact that fertile stockfish making breeding contributions in wild streams can actually reduce that all-important genetic variation. Taking a map of a river system, we can use a range of coloured dyes to represent the various ideal characteristics required of wild fish in different populations. These arbitrary colours will represent all of the amalgamated characteristics required to match a particular wild environment, and all of the wide variety of conditions found there. Our stockfish we can represent by a black dye. It's clear that adding black stockfish characteristics into the breeding output of each distinct wild population will make all populations more similar to each other by making them all similar to the domesticated stock strain. They're also a much poorer match to the original colour. In the same way, and as we already know, the characteristics that make good stockfish have much less success in the wild. As a consequence, hybrids between wild and domesticated trout do not fare quite as well as pure wild fish. This is because the genes carried by individuals are not infinitely moldable like clay. Instead, sets of genes carried by individual fish are more like model vehicle kits. If you're a stockfish, you might be carrying, let's say, the pieces for a model tank, but the local environment requires you to be a jet plane. There's only so close that you can get to the required prescription when you have the wrong kit. In the same way, even if you're hybrid between a stockfish and a wildfish, and you have half of each kit, you only have half of the right pieces that you need to complete the right kind of plane. This is the reason that even if you stock baby trout from a hatchery, they won't become wild as they grow up. To put it another way, if you're born with genes for colour blindness, you don't grow out of it by living amongst people who can see colours. An unexpected potential benefit of that poorer adaptation is that it can slow the rate at which stockfish characteristics invade wild populations. If no hybrids survive to adulthood, it would actually prevent any stockfish genes getting into the wild breeding populations at all. This isn't the entirely good news that it seems to be at first sight, though. To understand why, it's helpful to look at an extreme example. Studies of a sea trout population revealed there was no detectable survival at all of hybrids between stockfish and wild sea trout. The journey to and from sea proved fatal to all of the hybrids. In effect, any of the sea trout that mated with a stockfish would not actually add any offspring to the wild populations. In other words, the number of fish that were actually carrying out effective reproduction was much smaller than the number of reds, eggs, and fry would have suggested. This reduction in breeding population can have serious effects, but also does offer possibilities for recovery of populations that are locally adapted to their habitat. Ceasing stocking with fertile fish allows only wild fish to mate with each other and increases the chances that well-adapted offspring will be produced. Over time, this can bring back a good proportion of the distinctive characteristics of a particular population. However, because hybrids by definition carry both wild and domestic genes in the same body, it must be acknowledged that the process of natural selection that kills off hybrid fish carries a risk of eliminating some of those wild fish genes that are found in hybrids. Those losses might make it impossible to fully recover all the original wild characteristics. The only way to regain that genetic diversity is to wait for new mutations to arise in the future. But bear in mind that those original mutations arose during a couple of million years worth of evolution. We humans can wipe out those million years of evolution of genetic variations in just a few decades if we continue to stock with fertile fish. Avoiding stocking with fertile stockfish avoids the genetic impacts that we've outlined in this video. The Wild Trout Trust can help you with advice for supporting the wild fish in your streams. We can also give advice and assistance on rivers that don't support enough natural reproduction to support an angling amenity. So please go to our website for further details.